Mike good here? Yeah. All right. Thank you guys for coming out. Quick question, just because I have to know. My name is Tyler George from the USA curling team. How many of you guys watched curling at the Olympics this last time around? Jeez. All right. That's what we want to see. That's pretty good. So we're going to talk about curling analytics here today. I got Jerry Gertz and Kevin Palmer here, and they're going to do the brunt of the work, and I'm just going to give you a little intro. Our team with John Schuster, Matt Hamilton, John Landsteiner, myself formed in 2014, and we won the national championship together our first season, but we wanted to become a better team. We wanted to figure out how to get to the not just the national championship level, but the world and Olympic title level, and we ended up working with Jerry and Kevin, and we did a little meeting in Colorado Springs at the Olympic Training Center, where these guys put out these stats that we could use for matchups and for ourselves, you know, different situations where we were stronger, we were weaker, and we were able to pick out different weaknesses for our opponents and strengths for ourselves that we didn't realize before we looked at these tables. And I don't know that we would have been able to get to this point that we did as a team without these guys. And curling analytics is kind of a new frontier. It's not something that we used before 2015, 2016, just for our own matchups. And this is a big thing for the top teams in the world now. Anybody that's not using is at a disadvantage, and these guys are spearheading the effort. So I'm going to come back up at the end and answer any questions you guys might have too, but I'm going to turn things over to Kevin and Jerry and let them take the brunt. So go ahead, gentlemen.
Really appreciate the opportunity to be here to talk a little bit about curling analytics. But let's see here. First, a little bit about curling. For anybody who doesn't quite understand what's going on here, this little short video will kind of explain a little bit of the basics here.
In curling, two teams of four face off against each other. The object of the game is to slide granite stones down a sheet of ice towards a painted target of rings called a house. The team with a stone closest to the button or center of the rings scores a point. A team can score multiple points if they have more than one stone closer to the button than their opponent. Each game is broken up into 10 innings called ends. The four players in the lead, the second, the third, and the skip. The thrower pushes out of the hack and slides towards the target broom held by the skip. The other two players follow the rock and sweep with their brooms. Sweeping will do two things. It will limit the amount of curl and keep the rock straighter, or make it go further if it hasn't been thrown hard enough. The final two stones are thrown by the skip, with each team throwing 8 stones per end. The final stone thrown in the end is called the hammer. That's when the score is decided. The two basic shots in curling are a draw and a hit. A draw is intended to stop in the rings. A hit is intended to remove an opponent's stone from the rings. The skip will also use guards, which are rocks in front of the rings, to protect their stones from being removed. Almost like playing chess on ice, the skip will create a strategy using a mix of these shots to place those rocks so they can score at the completion of the end.
So there you go. A little bit about curling. This piece is actually from a documentary series released on Netflix today called Losers that Kevin was involved in. And it talks about a lot of the different sports, but there's a curling episode in that, so be sure to check that out. So when we talk about Team Schuster and, you know, an interesting note from that series, you know, we've all heard probably the miracle on ice term for Team Schuster and what they kind of overcame to go on to win the Olympic gold medal. But what you see here is the win probability chart after they were 2-4, and they dug themselves a bit of a hole. So what they had managed to do, what they accomplished in Pyeongchang at the Olympics is quite remarkable, and the miracle on ice term actually applies very well. And they managed to dig down and find what they needed to go on and win that gold medal. So, you know, a little interesting note here, you know, against the teams they played Canada, Switzerland, Great Britain, and then Canada in the semifinals, and then went on to beat Sweden in the gold medal game. Yeah. skip ahead. Not again. There we go. So going back to 2005 is where we started to dig into curling analytics. We published a couple books, and we started looking at win probability. So we took what we called the poker percentages, and we looked at every situation in the game. And we're collecting somewhere in the neighborhood of 8,000 to 10,000 games a season off of this stuff. So curling is one of these old sports, but it's very, very well set up for analytics. There's 16 stones thrown in an end, so there's 16 decision points in each end, 8 to 10 ends within the game. So there's so many points within a game where making decisions is important. And you can factor that into that decision making. So one of the first situations that we started looking into, and it was kind of the classic curling battle scenario. And you look at the last end of the game, a team is up one without last shot, without the hammer, or a team is down one with last shot, with the hammer. And common thinking within the sport was that you wanted to have control of that last shot. But the thing was, is that when we started looking at the numbers, come on. There we go. When we started looking at the numbers, it was actually the opposite. And it sort of played into the human element of having control. You're talking about high-performance athletes that when it's when the game's on the line, they want to be the players to actually go out there and make things happen. But the thing was, is they were actually putting themselves in the less preferable position. And it was something that sort of, kind of created a bit of a wave within the sport and created a lot of discussion around it. And even today, it's discussed often by commentators within the sport that they don't even truly totally understand this. So it's something where you start to take numbers to try and understand some concepts within the situation. So what we've done here, I'm not going to dig too deeply into this, but this is basically our poker percentages chart. We look at every game situation, every score differential, and we've got a historical win rate within those situations. So from this, we can start to kind of game plan and create strategies. What kind of risk do you want to take within within situations? This thing is, there we go. So they highlighted a couple key situations there. Tied in the last end, up one without hammer, down one without hammer, and then an early situation within the game as well.
So, thanks, Jerry. And back to that that interesting stat. I don't know if you caught it, but when a team is two down after the first end, as an example, a lot of time eight-end games, their win probability drops almost to 25%. So the interesting thing about curling, as Jerry says, is that the differential that you're in dramatically changes the strategy and how the game progresses. So within a game, and if you're a skip and you're on the ice, you've got to make quick decisions. But you can actually utilize the win probabilities. And here's a situation. Kind of it's a simplistic example with a bit of depth to it, but if you're the yellow team, you don't have last rock in that second to last end. So this is the ninth end now. And this is your last shot. So you're yellow, your opponent's sitting with a red stone wide open, and you need to decide, what should I do? Should I hit that stone? Well, if I hit it, I start to think in my mind, well, probably I'll blank and then I'll be at that 60% that we saw in the previous slide. Now, what about if I draw? What if I take a more aggressive approach? What might happen? So these are estimates I might determine in my head. So maybe half the time I'm going to miss the shot or I won't make it well enough. My opponent gets two. I'm going to drop to 40%. Well, maybe I can force the opponent 40% of the time, or might even steal, and then I win 90% of the time almost. So now in my head, I could actually quickly just do a quick math calculation. And I will say this isn't something commonly that curlers will do, but some that we know will actually use this type of a thought process. Just waiting for the build to... Has everyone done the math in their head already? We can... we'll show the calculations again. Fairly basic calculations, but in a very quick decision, you've got with a time clock deciding on what you need to do, what shot you need to call, you can sort of make an estimation that... If I can do this, if I can only give up two half the time, which I probably don't want to do, but it still might be worthwhile to make that aggressive play as opposed to just hitting an open stone and going into the next end with a 60% win percentage. So these are situations now where traditionally players would intuitively understand this, but now actually numbers are available to allow them to make game time decisions in the moment. So one of the other things, and if you've watched curling, you probably thought one of the first questions is, why does that team not want to score? Why aren't they taking a point? Why are they what they call blanking or forcing it so there's no stones in the house at the end of play on that end? So the reason is, intuitively, teams understood, well, I don't need to take one, I'd rather score two. But mathematically, we actually did a paper a few years ago that examined using the weighted values, and you can see here that actually a blank is preferable. These are essentially your win probability numbers as they would adjust based on the scoreboard. And a couple of other things that are interesting of note. So you're trying to score two. Three is, you know, twice as good as two, but there's diminishing returns as you score more. And for the most part in curling, teams are usually trying to score 2 points. Three usually happens by chance if your opponent makes a mistake or a half a mistake. You need your opponent to do something wrong, generally, to try to get those 3 or 4 points. And so that sort of leads into that. And the other point, of course, is the results from a final end wouldn't be using these calculations because it's always going to be beneficial to take one if you're tied in that final end. Jerry?
So some of this stuff seems pretty realistic, and it's really one of the challenges that bringing new information and analytics to a sport is definitely a learning process. And when we talk about this stuff, it's been in the works for over a decade, but it really wasn't put in place with high-level competitive teams till about 2 years ago. And it's taken some time to find the right teams and the right mix of athletes to actually adapt it and start using it as part of their game. So the next thing we look at, we dig a little deeper into the numbers, and we call these our efficiency statistics. And I don't want to get too technical here, but hammer efficiency and steel defense are two statistics when you have the last shot at the end, or the hammer. So hammer efficiency is the percentage of time you take two or more, so that's your scoring efficiency. Steel defense, that's how much you limit your opponents from stealing points on you. And these are two very important components to being a successful team. Then, of course, without the hammer, we've got force efficiency, which is holding your opponents to a single point when they score on you. And then steel efficiency is how good are you at stealing points on your opponents. So what we end up doing is we use these stats to dig a little deeper into teams' profiles. And so what we do then is we break down every scenario into a title. So we call it long shot, severe, deficit control, dominant, ultimate. And all that does is it takes the numbers out of the head of the players. It just puts it into a more simplistic view. And the interesting thing is when you look at the expected win rate at any given time in a game, it's pretty consistent for the score differential as well. So being down one with the hammer, you're in a deficit situation, putting you somewhere between 45% to win the game. So it makes it a lot easier to categorize these situations all together in one. So what you do there, you see the circles in the blue section there in the first section. BL, that column is blank ends. So we look at the percentage of the time that an end is blanked. And this kind of shows the aggressiveness of an opponent. Are they playing a more open, conservative style of game? Or are they putting rocks in play and kind of going for it? So the higher that number is, the more likely you are to play open game. Hammer efficiency, steel defense. And then we use these numbers to kind of dig into how a team approaches the game. And so in a real game situation here, this goes back to the Olympic gold medal final, the women's final. So Tyler set up, we did a little bit of work with the US men's program, but we worked extensively with Anna Hasselberg's team out of Sweden last year, game planned all their opponents and everything. And this is the situation analysis report going into the gold medal game. I was praying they would get to play the Koreans when the semifinal matchup set up, because this was the easiest game plan I created all year. And it was for the gold medal game, which, you know, you think, okay, this is the pressure game, the big game. And the women went out there and they dominated the game. It was probably the easiest game they played. But when you look at the profile, what it shows is the Koreans were winning because they were playing hyper-aggressive and they were stealing in all key tight game situations a ton. And that's what made them successful, which was different from most opponents. So by going back, looking at some of the shots and understanding how they approached it, the whole game plan was, if the Koreans put a rock in the middle or you have a rock in the middle when you have hammer, you hit it. You don't give them something to hide behind. And it ended up being a pretty boring game. I actually was working for CBC in Canada, who was doing the commentary as well, feeding them information, and I sent a text message to the commentators apologizing for the boring game they were going to get. But from there, they had the game plan, they knew exactly what the Korean strength was, and they went out there and executed it and won the gold medal. And working with Team Hasselberg has also been a very interesting approach for them. They really bought into the numbers and the analytics, and they were a young team. They were 22nd ranked in the world 2 years before the Olympics. They were very skilled athletes. They did everything they needed to do, the nutrition, training, competing, but they also added analytics to the table, and they knew everything about every opponent they had to play, and every game plan that they approached was different. Most teams approach the game from a, we're going to play our game, and that's going to be good enough to win. They did something different, and they went on to become Olympic gold medalists because of it. Come on. You want to take this one? Kevin again?
So just quickly, one thing that actually factors in and in the sport of curling, and so just thinking in terms of related to other sports, runs created, if you're, you know, in baseball as an example, is irrelevant in something like curling. Whether you score 12 points or 6 points is really doesn't matter. And we see teams that take different strategies and approaches and have success. So it really comes down to the score differential and how many ends are remaining. And what this chart's really showing you is that the actual probability of an outcome of a score varies greatly based on the actual differential in the score. So that's how we have to break down these numbers. And then the other thing is, if the probability of that success isn't very absolute, it varies with many, many factors. Some people may not even be aware that the ice conditions will actually not only change within an event, it could change during a game, in fact. So the players are obviously always making adjustments. So even if you have numbers, you've got to adjust them based on these chances. And the other interesting thing fundamentally about the sport makes it very difficult for us to analyze. A team like Schuster might play a certain level of teams, they might play a certain number of games, but everything's different. There's no league of 32 teams that plays 82 games. So the issue we have is it's almost like if all of the professional baseball leagues randomly played games against each other and we were trying to then evaluate their performance based on who they played. So there's still work to be done to try to adjust those numbers. So just maybe going into a bit what's next. So one of the things that we do need to do, we're working off of line scores right now, and we are starting to measure the locations of the first few rocks of each end. What the sport really does need is starting to get cameras and sensors where we could track every single rock, study more of the physics of the sport, and then also start to compile more data that we could do even more work with. That's really going to improve things, and as I commented before, trying to improve rankings and understanding the statistics adjusted based on who teams are playing and what their skill level is. One other interesting thing that's being done here, and this is one example out of the University of Alberta. This is a phenomenal school that works a lot in artificial intelligence and solved heads-up poker, and they worked on a number of other gaming projects. They've actually been building models around curling. And it's a very, very interesting problem because, of course, all of the pieces that I talked about in terms of the probability of shots being made or not being made. So it's a very, we'll see over the next few years how that develops. But no input from any curling experts, just building a machine that will try to solve the sport. And obviously, as Jerry said, we've had an incredible amount of interest from players and coaches, particularly in the last couple of years and with these Olympic wins. I think Jerry forgot to mention, but just recently, Chelsea Carey, a team that just won the Canadian Championship, which is the Scotty's Tournament of Hearts, and we've been working with that team. So it's kind of exciting as teams, coaches, and countries now are trying to gather more information. But it really was a light switch turning.
Yeah, it's been a really neat opportunity to kind of develop and grow this within the sport. Going back to the work with Curling Zone, it all started with creating a scoring system for the sport. But at the time, this was early 2000s when I started doing that, an interesting book that sort of turned its head on baseball analytics came out called Moneyball. I'm sure everybody's aware of that one. But the, probably the best lesson that I learned from reading that book had nothing to do with numbers, but the execution of using those numbers and the patience that you have to develop this. A lot of this information, the tools and everything used to win Olympic golds in 2018 was developed for the US program in 2010. So it took almost a decade before we finally found teams that were able to add this to their repertoire and build and optimize their game behind it. So, you know, that's probably the biggest lesson that I think anybody here can learn is patience and overcoming the human element within a lot of this stuff too. It's definitely really intriguing for what's coming next. Our program is our 2.0 project. We're working on a 3.0, which is tracking every stone, as Kevin was talking about. And now going into a situation where we start to look at what kind of tactics are actually the best return. So, you know, when a team plays this and plays that, we'll end up then being able to say whether something is actually the right call or not as well. So it's been really a great opportunity and a lot of fun doing this as well.
So I think we have a bit of time left for questions. And I don't know if, Tyler, you want to pop back up and then, or they're going to take your microphone.
Just be loud up here. You can hear you.
It's on? All right. So please raise your hand and I'll bring it over.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
One quick question. You've got a lot of interesting data and breakdowns according to raw probabilities. But you're probably friends with a bunch of physicists who look at spin and trajectory and all those sorts of things. How much do you think you could improve a model with figuring out something about the simulation of the physical process to just add in immediately to the sorts of things you're already doing?
So this is a project that another guy that we know in Canada that is working on this, and he's using a camera system to actually track deliveries, like when a player throws a stone, but also tracks the amount of rotation that he puts on the stone. The amount of rotation that a player puts on the stone when they release it, he's found, can drastically affect the shot. And one of the players that he ended up working with was a friend of his, and when she threw wider on the sheet, she had to go wider out to make a shot, she was actually throwing less rotation on her stones, just naturally because it's a little bit more of a difficult shot. So she was focusing on her target rather than her natural delivery, and she was throwing less rotation, and because of that, it was affecting her shot. So this is certainly some of the next generation stuff to come. Right now, it's all about, you know, how much information do we throw in front of the players, and, you know, paralysis by analysis is definitely a challenge that we have to overcome and be careful with at the same time. So, you know, a lot of this stuff, you know, the sky's the limit in this game. And it's going to be interesting to see how it develops and evolves over time. Anybody else got any questions?
Yep, one more here.
Hey, guys. So I'm wondering if you ever have a challenge scoring, like, for instance, in football and basketball, you don't always know the intention of the play, right? So you have a shot. How are you able to score the shot if you ever have an issue saying, like, this is exactly where they want to put it, or, I don't know, right, if you have a guard strategy, whatever. Can you guys speak to that?
Well, to be honest, sometimes the people who are doing scoring and curling don't even know what the call is because the players don't truly articulate it a lot of times. And sometimes there's even shots where it's kind of a little bit of a rope-a-dope type of play, where you're trying to do something you don't even really want your opponent to know for sure what you're doing. So it's really comes down to doing the best thing. The thing is, the data that we use is solid because it's set line score data. It is what it is. In curling, there's shooting percentages data that I didn't even touch on here, and it's actually one of my jobs within the sport to go to tournaments and track shot-by-shot shooting percentage data. But we still have a data problem there where the people doing the data entry are volunteers and the knowledge base is pretty wide-ranging. So that information, while very valuable, if used properly, is still a challenge within the game right now.
And shooting percentages as a whole are totally subjective. Before you even get into what they were trying to do, what they weren't trying to do, plan A's, plan B's, with the shot you're trying to play, a lot of the scoring that you'd see like during the Olympics, I don't think they took a difficulty of the shot into account. So our team's percentage was quite a bit lower for the week than some of the other top teams. And a lot of that was due to the fact that, well, we did struggle a little at the beginning, but we were playing more difficult shots. We played with more rocks to play. So you're just not gonna shoot 90-95% with the style of play that we have. So it's, as I think Jerry mentioned too, that you have to factor in your stats head to head. So like when we play the Swedes, their stats will drop because we're gonna put more rocks in play. We're gonna force the issue on them. We're not gonna let them play a simplistic game. And they're probably gonna drop maybe 10% from the games they play us. And over the course of the week, then you're gonna see our numbers probably middle of the pack just because the style of play that we have. So yeah, the scoring and the percentages are completely subjective in the first place too.
I think we're pretty much out of time here. We don't wanna hold up anybody else, but I'd like to thank everybody for showing up here. We really appreciate the attention for curling, and I'd like to thank Tyler and Kevin, and thanks a lot, everyone.
Yeah, thanks. Good job, Dan. All right.